welcome to the live stream with the Thejunkman. This is my special guest, Colorado Dual Sport. I'm glad to have you in here. If you're online on YouTube or something, why don't you say something in the chat? It's right over here. Dang it. It's always backwards to me. I've done this only a couple of other times. But anyway, let me introduce the Colorado Dual Sport. He's another YouTuber just like me, but only he does moto vlogs. So I guess let's just start right there, because most of my viewers out there aren't moto vloggers. So let's first get that out of the way. What is a moto vlogger? How would you describe it?
The best explanation of moto vlogging that I've ever heard of was done by my buddy Herman DeVlog. And basically the way he describes it in short is wearing a television studio on your head and riding your motorcycle around and talking to people who are also dual sport enthusiasts or motorcycle enthusiasts in general.
Yep, and of course I watch your videos too, so I know you're pretty heavy in the dual sport and motor vlogging community here. Mm-hmm. So, like I said, I would invite a lot of my viewers, if you haven't checked him out, like I said, after this stream, I'd say go check out his channel.
Thank you.
But I first want to get started. How did you get started into motorcycling? Because I do know that you're fairly new to it, mm-hmm. within the last few years, mm-hmm. but was it a deal? Did you, as a kid, did you have a dirt bike, or did you ride street bikes maybe in high school, or anything along that lines, or was it totally like all of a sudden you got the urge? And I mean, tell the story.
The story is a pretty simple one. I grew up in Lawrenceville, New Jersey, and in New Jersey, owning a dirt bike is basically just asking to get a ticket, get the motorcycle confiscated, and...
Well, there can't be a lot of... too many places to ride. I mean, there's a lot of trees, no. And then it's fairly densely populated.
No, so...
I've only been there once in my life, so,
yeah.
I mean,
So it's basically, I was the kid that always had Jeremy McGrath pictures in my locker, and, I wanted the, Suzuki RM125 was my baby. And I had picture, my entire locker, my whole room at home was decked out in motocross pictures and whatnot. But I just, wasn't allowed to. My parents wouldn't let me have one.
Now, let me just stop you there. Were they into things mechanical, motors, cars, fast cars, or classic cars, anything like that?
No.
My parents
got divorced when I was young.
Okay.
When my parents were together, we lived in a place in Pennsylvania where my brother had like a mini bike.
Okay.
So, I remember a little bit about riding around on that, but when they got divorced when I was about 6, and I went to live with my mother in New Jersey.
Okay.
And that was pretty much
the thing. Oh, yeah. Generally, moms don't don't like motorcycles.
Yeah.
I would say mine's the exception because she rides motorcycles,
yeah.
even at 65 years of age.
Really?
Or roughly 65. Actually.
That's awesome.
Sorry, Mom, I can't remember how old you are.
That's awesome. Hi, Joe Fans, Mom. You're my new hero.
But anyway, I wish you got into it. But, that stands to reason. I mean, in that situation, in general, moms don't like dirt bikes. So.
Yeah.
But I guess let me fast forward this a little bit. So when you, say, got out of high school, turned 18, when you're legally yourself, I mean, you might have still been living at home, sort of,
mm-hmm.
but how come, I mean, I know there's probably the money issue, but
right.
But why not at least try to get an old junker like I like to work on here and do whatever? I mean,
so at that point, when I got out of high school, I actually moved out of my house on my 18th birthday.
Okay.
I moved into my first apartment with my first long-term girlfriend. So my focus was
okay.
was a little different.
Another thing. Yeah, you got moms and then girlfriends. Yeah,
Well, no, she was the adventurous type. She wanted
Okay.
So,
hey, no, and they're out there. No, and I'm glad you found one.
So when I tell this story, I usually leave out this part. But what happened was a buddy of mine actually gave me an old Honda, and I, for the life of me, can't remember what model it was. But
what,
it wasn't
what displacement, or do you even remember?
No, I don't.
Okay.
I honestly don't. I could probably pull up a picture from the archives.
Okay.
It'd take me a while to find it. But anyway, he gave it to me, and he said something was broken, and if I got it fixed, everything else on it was fine, and I'd be able to learn how to ride with him.
Okay.
I was like, all right, cool. So at that time, again, money very limited. You know,
of course,
we're
of
dealing
course.
In cash only on a lot of things.
Yep, yep.
I took it down to a shop and I said, "Hey, can you guys take a look at this and fix it?" They came back to me like a week later and were like, "It's going to cost more than this bike is worth to actually
well,
fix
that,
it." So dream dashed.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Dream
well,
totally dashed.
A lot of my viewers know that because a lot of my comments are centered around, "Oh, how can I make this bike run, but I don't, you know, the dealer or somebody wants to spend this." It's like, that's generally the case. I got a bike right behind you that I probably spent close to almost what it's worth in fixing it up, even though I only paid $50 for it.
Right, but it was just
that's kind of the same issue. I understand.
And
you have to do it because you love it.
Right,
and
at that point I didn't have any friends that were mechanically inclined. I didn't have any tools, anything like that.
Yep.
So from there it kind of just went, you know, on the back burner. And it was still something that I was always interested in, and whenever I would catch, you know, motocross races on TV or something, I would, you know, lock the channel and had to watch it, sort of stuff. But then as life went on, I always wanted a motorcycle, and I just really didn't know how to get into it because I didn't know anybody else that was into it. So we moved out here, and I finally started making enough money to say, all right, I can make a good, fun purchase.
Yes.
You know?
Yep.
So I started doing some research. And in doing that research is actually how I found the Moto Vloggers.
Well, that's interesting because my next question kind of leads into that is, you know, how did you find the DRZ? Now, I mean, me, growing up around motorcycles, just magazines, and then when the internet come on, and then I've worked on them since I was little, along with other things.
I'm jealous.
But, you know, and I remember when the DRZ came out, and I have the earlier iteration, the DR350 back here.
Mm-hmm.
And when that came out, it was like, that was the bike, and then all through, like I said, you didn't get one until
2013,
see?
Yeah.
And they virtually not changed that bike, but there's no reason to.
Right.
But it's funny that you, not really knowing what kind of bike you should buy,
I
found
no idea.
It because it is the perfect, perfect kind of beginner dirt bike if you're a full-grown adult. I mean,
yeah. What I
and for dual sporting, I mean, yeah, just tons of aftermarket and everything, and that's why I found it really odd or surprising that became your first bike. Because sometimes people like you, you know, they buy a street bike or they buy, you know, a Honda XR or something,
right?
And then have to trailer it around in the dirt and then decide that they want a dual sport.
Well,
or street legal.
Well, there was a bunch of criteria that the DRZ met for me, which kind of made it the perfect bike. I wanted something that was off-road oriented, but I could also put a license plate on because at that time we didn't have a trailer.
Exactly.
We didn't know anything.
There
about
you go.
This.
And
I
most, you know, that thing about trailer and hauling it. A lot of people they'll buy a dirt bike and then realize, how do I get it?
Right. Yeah. How do I get it then? Right.
I've had friends that have done that. That's like.
But the other thing that I wanted was something that was road legal, not only for the trailering aspect, but also because I didn't know how to ride a motorcycle. You know, I had a basic understanding of driving a manual car and all that, but I had never actually ridden a motorcycle for real. So I wanted something that I could ride around on the road, in the parking lot, you know, do
get your
6,000 circles
exactly.
and figure eights. And like, I started at zero
well,
notch.
And you did this teaching yourself virtually, right?
Yeah.
See, and folks out there, this is what you got to do. You just can't go buy, you know, a CBR 600RR. And just set out on the street.
Right.
Get something and small, or at least do like he did, and realize my skills are limited, and own that, and learn how to handle the bike.
Right.
You're a perfect example of how you should go about it, especially where you didn't have any outside influence.
Right.
You know. Yet. And until you got into the community, obviously.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but
in the last
we're talking,
3 years, my knowledge has grown immensely. But the other thing that I liked about the DRZ, after starting to do some research on it, my choice was between the DRZ and the KLR 650. So I needed to make a conscious decision of whether I wanted to do more long-distance touring or something that was going to be more hardcore off-road. And once I did decide on the DRZ, which I don't know. Do you mind if I plug a video that helped me make my decision?
No, because I was gonna plug it at the end of the video.
Okay. So Everride, Tyler did a video called the Dual Sport Deathmatch.
Yep. I've seen the video. Yep. Good video, by the way. If I remember this, I will link it in the description of this video so archives can go to that. And I'm also gonna link his channel too for you guys out there.
This one's gonna be down there, not over there.
Yeah.
But anyway, I watched that video and I decided on the DRZ, and what I started to learn about the DRZ is it's actually a bike that will grow with you. The DRZ stock, everybody in the community knows that it's a great bike, it's one of the most reliable dual sports that are on the market, but it's not known for being fast or flashy or hardcore.
Nope, and you know, I'll stop you right here, because I have some experience in the quad world, and like I said, remember, you know, pretty vividly when that bike came out in the magazines and everything, and I couldn't understand why the quad got the same carburetor that your S model has, CV type, I forget the size, but it's a Makuni BS model, but anyways, beside the point, it's a very good carburetor for drivability. Mm-hmm. It's sort of self-adjusting, but performance, no. I mean, I still have the BS on my DR350 back there. And the reason why I'm taking it and upgraded to an FCR or something along those lines is for the drivability, I think. Right. And with that bike, I could care less about performance. But you're right. The E model, you know, has the more performance-oriented carburetor. Mm-hmm. I always wondered why the quad got the street bike.
Yeah,
you know,
that
almost emissions-type carburetor didn't make any sense. Mm-hmm. Because I had swapped a lot of those carburetors over on those, and we were going, you know, trying to find people who were selling them, and you couldn't find them at that time, because that was the hot mod. That was the hot mod to do.
Well, it's like that in cans.
Yes. Yeah, well, there was the cans.
Big board.
Yeah, but really, 400cc, the stock 400cc is enough. You don't even need to put a pipe on the thing, just get that carburetor tuned up, and there you go.
I'll tell you, at elevation, the airbox mod, the pipe and the header made a enormous
difference. Yes, and for those of you out there that don't know elevation, he means that, I mean, right now, where we're sitting, we're at about 5,600 feet, and if you watch his videos, he sometimes tells us that.
Yeah.
We're going up, you know, north of 13,000, we're already lost about 10% of our horsepower just sitting here.
Mm-hmm.
And then we go up there, and you're getting closer to like 18, 20.
Yeah. Our normal rides are between 8 and 11. I mean, sometimes we'll go higher or lower, but that's the norm for what we do on a weekly basis.
Yeah. So, yeah, he's right. But I guess I want to clarify for those out there thinking about the DRZ, as their first bike, you don't have to go out and put that pipe on there.
And the exciting thing is actually I've taken it down to St. George, Utah a couple of times, which is at about 2,000 and 2,500 feet, and that's much closer to sea level than we are. Obviously, it's half the distance, but Zeno would like really wanted to power wheelie in first year.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And it was like, for me, even having it for two years,
and actually,
my mind was blown.
Now, being a four stroke, it's not as big a deal, but it probably was running a little bit leaner, which that contributes to your power.
It's awesome.
I'm originally, some of you know, I'm originally from Nebraska, which is around that 2,000 feet deal. And yeah, when I take my bike to races that go to those lower elevations, it's like sometimes I would have to reject just a teensy bit because it would want to get a little hot.
Right.
Too high performance two stroke, a little different story. But
yeah.
Anyways.
Yeah.
So.
But yeah, it's we call it the altitude mod.
Yeah. Well, it's good. More air in and more air out. You make more power in between generally.
Exactly.
Generally speaking.
Yeah.
Got a couple comments coming in here.
Got any good questions yet?
Yeah, we need a few questions though. We have a Yamasaki 17500. Old bikes are easy to work on, but the parts are harder and more expensive to find.
So that's not true with the DRZ though. But because the design is so old, that a lot of the parts are they're still creating the parts, so that they're still available.
Exactly. But in general, you're right for kind of the stuff I work on.
Yes.
But yeah,
for
but that
for these.
Yeah. But he's right. That's the other benefit of the DRZ is they hold their value well, and yes, like I said, because the bike virtually didn't change its whole life. I mean,
yeah.
Minor updates here and there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's not esoteric part of it. I can't tell you how many, especially through the 80s, when motorcycling was really evolving, especially in motocross and the play bike and dirt bike and
mm-hmm.
the precursors to dual sports and race dual, or race enduros, I should say, you know, the XL and XR 500s, XR 350s and things, they changed them almost every year.
Oh.
So when you buy those bikes,
yeah.
You're looking for esoteric parts, you know?
Right? That are going to be very
yeah.
few and far between.
Yeah. So
I'm sad I missed that time. That's not. I bet you it was a ton of fun.
It was. I mean,
it probably hurt a lot, but it was probably.
Yeah.
A ton of fun.
I mean, actually, I grew up, you know, a little later, but I grew up on a lot of these old dual shock vintage bikes from the early 70s, and yeah, with three, maybe 3.5 inches of suspension traveling to rear, maybe four. I mean, we were talking before the stream. He watched one of my archive videos from, it's on my channel. It's called like Vintage Motocross Riding or something. You know, it was recorded on analog tape. It was a VHS.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
Anyway, I mean, so that was.
Classic footage.
So that was,
classic.
You know, that was early to mid-ish 90s.
Mm-hmm.
So those bikes were already getting pushing the 30-year-old
mm-hmm.
mark,
mm-hmm.
and I, you know, and those are the bikes I cut my teeth on.
Yeah.
So I guess I have a little bit different appreciation for things like we're
right.
going to see here in a minute, and also like your DRZ and even my more modern bikes I have back here, but
mm-hmm.
and that aren't in the shop. But yeah,
mm-hmm.
it's there's no better time to be into motorcycling in my opinion from whether you want. A stone cold reliable bike, or you want some high performance racer,
mm-hmm.
Like the new 450s. They're literally an eighth of an F1 motor,
right?
I mean,
well,
and they run like them too. And that's where you get into those debates about reliability. And the DRZ takes some of that technology, but tones it down enough that it makes it reliable enough
mm-hmm.
for someone like you that's not really by admission mechanically inclined.
Right.
And
yeah.
there's nothing wrong with that.
No, absolutely.
It makes it so you don't have to worry about it.
But it's also teaching me how to work on it.
It is.
And
it's
super simple.
Well, you're always going to learn. But, I mean, even if you have to take it to the dealer, that is fine. But it's going to be cheaper because it's an
yeah.
easy bike to work
oh,
on.
The first time I took a wrench to that bike, I was terrified that I was going to do something that would make the bike not run anymore. And here goes my first large investment other
yeah.
than my car.
Now,
screwed, you know?
Okay, now this is funny because I'm the other way with... kind of computers and technology.
Oh, computers, forget about it.
I mean, I just had one go down on me about a couple hours before we were going to go live, and I had to swap everything over. But I really don't know how I'm going to fix that, truthfully.
Mm-hmm.
I'll figure it out, but I mean...
Right, but computers are tear apart,
like,
no
like,
problem.
Like you turning that wrench,
yeah.
The anxiety you have, that's what I'm having.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean,
mm-hmm.
we're the same in a lot of respects.
Right.
That way, it's just different things.
Well, I can just tell you right now that you're not going to really break anything on there, don't worry. And anything that you do break is just the same as these bikes. It's a replaceable bike.
Yeah, well, that's a funny thing. I do have some friends that are into the IT stuff. I was very apprehensive of building my first PC for a long time. Because it's like, I don't know, how do you know what's compatible with what?
Mm-hmm.
And one of them said, God damn it, I've seen you tear motorcycles down to every nut and bolt and put them back together. You can put together.
Right. yeah, it should be like easy.
But I tell you, it still scares me, that kind of stuff. I mean, even just swapping a video card out, and that's plug and play.
Right.
It's like, oh my God, am I going to bend one of them teeny tiny pins in there?
Yeah, yeah, but it's the same thing, you know, and now I'm,
well,
you know,
I wanna,
I'm down to doing my own oil changes and changing my gas tank and,
yep.
you know, still not super involved with mechanical stuff, but now I no longer have
no,
that
but it's
anxiety.
Confidence inspiring.
Yeah.
Every
right.
little bit
right.
helps. Every
right.
little bit helps.
I'm still leaving any of the engine stuff to these guys, but...
We got a few more comments here. Let's see what we got.
Oh, while you're checking that out, I just wanted to give one mention to one thing. One of your videos was actually one of the first videos I ever saw about dual sporting.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't know that... Actually, before you tell your story, let me just say, dual sporting, I used to think you had to be over 50 before you could enjoy that. That's totally wrong. All right. But
I say dual sporting in a sense that you were more motocrossing on a trail, but that's what I say. Since I'm mostly involved in the dual sporting genre, I just use that as an overarching term.
Sure. Okay.
You know, so one of your trail videos was actually one of the first videos I ever saw. So so I wanted to
because you were wanting to move to Colorado, is that it?
Well, yeah. We were already here, and I was trying to figure out where to go ride. At that point.
Wow. Because especially my trail riding videos are terrible.
Well, I was looking at you had a lot of Rampart Range videos.
Yes, and that was terrible because the camera I was using, like I said, I think the GoPro might have been just out or early.
It wasn't a GoPro.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't. And the GoPro was just out, so it was really expensive.
Uh-huh.
And this was I had actually bought it before the GoPro, I think, even released, but there was rumors of it. But this was like 480p, whatever. I can't even remember it.
You must have had a chesty mount or something.
Yeah,
it was rough, but it conveyed what I needed to know.
Yeah, it was that video was more those videos, I should say, are just a test. Like I said, I can't believe that's the one you come across because those are my. I mean, I don't make high end content. Like I said, go check out Everide if you want to see cinematics.
Yeah, you're one of those first guys. You're like,
And I missed the boat because I should have bulked up on technology and been.
Yeah. But you're still, you know, one of the OGs. You know,
I'm a YouTube OG just by the date. But we've got some good questions in here actually. That Yamasaki says, is the DRZ heavy and is there different sizes? I'll let you just answer. I know, but you can answer this.
Well, here's one of the reasons that I went with the DRZ is because it's not very heavy. I'm 6'3", 300 pounds, so I'm a big guy. And that's one of the reasons that I chose to get the 400 over one of the 250s, which a lot of the smaller people tend to go with because they're lighter and easier to manage. But for somebody that's my size, a 250 is just plain old too small. It's not.
Now, we're talking like play bike 250.
Yeah, well, no, I mean, even like a WR.
Okay.
Even though WR is a full-size bike, true. When I sit on it, I feel like a gorilla.
Yeah, I can see that.
I just fit better on the DRZ. So when I get asked a lot of these questions, the first thing I do is ask back is, well, how tall are you, how much do you weigh, and what do you expect to ride? Those are the three most common factors in what bike you want to pick, and that'll give you at least a good starting point.
See, I'm not the best to ask about kind of almost do it all type bikes like this because I choose my bike for the situation that I'm going to ride.
You're a very specific situation.
I choose to use the right tool for the right job, but
I wanted a bike that does it all.
But I had the luxury of doing it that way. But I also wanted to be as most diverse as I could. You know, I mean, there's still a few types of racing I haven't done. But
yeah, see, I never wanted to race, so that was one goal that I didn't have. I just wanted to enjoy myself, getting out, you know.
Yeah, no, and that's the beauty of motorcycling. Even the Harley guys, you know, they're having a good time.
Right, they're out riding, they're out seeing the country, exactly. And you know, I mean, we have different objectives in our plan, but our overall goal is the same.
Yep. We got another question here. Come in. Oh, what's your favorite motorcycle? I'll let you start, and then I'll say mine. I guess, let me preface this. Are you asking what my favorite motorcycle is that is ever made, like I don't own it but would like to own it, or do you mean of what I own? Because I have a lot of different bikes, if you follow me. But you can
start. That's a really easy question for me. But also an extremely difficult one because I own two bikes now. Are we telling them? They know?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Well, yes. We're building up here because it's in the title. We're going to show you his new bike and we're going to talk about how you acquired this thing, which is quite a nice story. Okay. If you've watched his videos, you already know this.
But I have the 2013 DRZ 400S, and I also have a brand new 2016 Honda Africa Twin. Asking between the two of those which one is my favorite, I honestly can't answer that question. because I bought those bikes. I'm starting to diversify like you, where I have these two bikes for two very different purposes. I also only have 1,100 miles on the Africa Twin, so I don't even feel like I could make even the beginning of a statement like that, because I just don't have enough experience riding it. Since my channel has been solely focused on the DRZ for so long, you know, I love the DRZ and rave about it and have no shame, because I have tons of experience with that bike in a meager, you know, 3 years, but, you know, my knowledge has grown immensely, and I'm very happy with that purchase, and I recommend it to people.
Well, and it has. Like, it's actually been fun for me to watch your videos from the beginning, because I kind of forgot what it was like to be new when everything was kind of new, and even discovering out here. I mean, I discovered out here a long time ago, obviously, mm-hmm. but and still enjoy everywhere. But it was neat seeing it through a first-timer's eyes again. Because it was like, oh, yeah, I remember doing it when I did that trail for the very first time. I mean, my first video, since you said what first video you watched, mine was, I don't know what it was titled, but you were going up, I call it Kingston.
Kingston Peak. But that was my first three videos series.
Okay. And here's the thing, is then it amazed me when I found out that you've only had this bike for couple of months.
I had it for literally two months, and you were trying
a trail like that, which it's not overly hard, but it's not overly easy either.
It's a hard trail.
Well, it's hard, but like
it's not like the most difficult trail in the entire world. But for a newbie, I should not have done that.
No,
trail.
For a newbie, no way if ends or buts. So it was.
And I made it almost the whole way. I made it to the last hill.
Yeah. No, I remember.
I did the super hard part.
Exactly, because I was like, well, why were you having troubles right there? You already got through the hardest stuff. But you're getting tired by that time, and up here you're huffing and puffing, and then if you're not used to this altitude, or that altitude, I mean, even coming from where we are, sitting right here right now, and going up there, you'll feel it, you know, if you haven't been up there a while. I guess I'll answer. My favorite bike that I own is, it's actually sitting back here. It's my Buell.
Your baby.
Well, it's my favorite. I mean, it's hard to choose one, but it's my favorite, I guess, partially because it's the only bike I bought almost brand new. It had 20 miles on it.
What is it?
It's an XB 9SX, the Lightning series of bikes. It's the City Cross, is what they call it. It's the same as the XB9. It's 996, so roughly 1,000.
Nearly 1,000.
What it is, for those that aren't familiar, and like I said, I could do a whole video about why I wanted a Buell and why it's kind of special, or Buells are kind of special in the motorcycling world in a way.
Well, it's not a name you hear very often.
No, like I said, it could be a whole, so I won't go into all of it. But really, I wanted it because Buell itself, the company, is unique in how it got started, the guy who designed the bike, the technology behind it, and it was an attainable exotic, I guess, for me.
Okay.
It was an attainable exotic, and it was American made. I'm not a Harley person, but I'm not a Harley hater, but I will never own I shouldn't say never, but.
So that's like your Maserati.
Yes, okay. or the Chrysler Audi. maybe that's what I call it, because it's got a Harley-based engine in it. Basically, this is an 883 Sportster engine, of course, bored out, roller cams, higher compression. So, you know, like the 883 makes like 70 horsepower or something. Somebody will correct me in the comments later, and they'll be like, oh, it makes this. No, that makes about 100 horsepower.
Okay.
In my opinion, the Buell should have been what the Sportster evolved into.
Okay.
If Harley was going for that market. Well, anyway, that's partly why I bought it. It was just unique. It had a uniqueness to it, and some of the features. And that's, so of the bikes I own, that's my, I guess, my favorite. I commute on it. It's probably the bike that it's not the bike I put the most miles on by any means. That was my XS 1100, which I put over 100,000 miles on. But That's the only bike I ever sold. Because everybody asks, "Are you selling bikes?" It's like, well, no, but that's the only one I've ever sold.
I'm never gonna sell my DRZ. Xena is gonna stay until she
rides.
But that
bike was purely bought for long range travel, and I bought it cheap, and I didn't. I mean, I kept it nice, but I didn't care about it. I didn't get a sentimental value. It didn't have any sentimental value to me.
Right.
So that's kind of why it was easier to let go to them.
Well, I think
that's
why you restored the 70s bikes, because that's sentimental right there.
Yeah, those are for my dad, you know. That, like I said, if you watch my Barn Fresh series, I tell the whole story there, so we're not going into that in here. Of all my bikes, and I have, close to, in total, you know, like over 30, probably 20-ish, 20 of all that are run, ride. Probably about 15 of them are in full restored, not like good shape, you know. Anyways, let's check out the chat here.
We're gonna need a bigger garage, Miss Stacy.
Yeah. Okay, we got one. This is directed at you, CDS. What is one motorcycle you've wanted? I mean, I think you have it. We're teasing it. We'll show it. But I mean, is there? Let's exclude that bike. Other than that. Like, before you knew that existed.
Before I knew that existed. Okay. It's basically going to describe what that bike does. As I got the DRZ and started riding, I realized that I liked riding far. I really, really, really enjoy fire road rides. I like doing, 200 miles and seeing different beautiful places and even just scouting trails that way. Like going out, I'll take the Africa Twin and, ride to somewhere, and then I'll put a waypoint at a spot that looks like it might be a little too rough for the Africa Twin, but I want to come back here with the DRZ.
That's smart.
Yeah, like,
I don't think I have that much.
I think, well, it works out well with the spot and, other variants of equipment that I carry, but it suits that need for me to be able to go far and fast and have fun. You're flying down these dirt roads, standing up riding, just kind of, that's my throttle therapy, totally empties my mind.
Yeah.
But then I still do love the challenge of riding a gnarly trail and getting on the DRZ and just cranking up some of these.
See, and I think you're figuring out that's why I have so many bikes,
uh-huh.
Because certain, like this Buell, like I said, it's my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
I did one long, and that was enough,
mm-hmm.
one long distance ride, and that was enough to cure me, like, of doing long distances on that bike.
Yeah.
For those, you don't know, like I said, I didn't want to go too much. Okay, one of the unique features is the fuel tank is the frame.
Oh.
Okay.
That's different.
So, yeah, but that also means that it only holds 3.6 gallons.
Oh.
Okay?
Yeah.
Gets about 50 miles a gallon, but that puts
your
range at, like, you're wanting to find a gas station just to calm your nerves at about 150 miles.
Well, that's terrible.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Great commuter.
Yeah.
Terrible long distance.
Right.
But I did a long distance all in one sitting. Did with obviously the gas stops, but other than that,
mm-hmm.
Did 800 miles round trip. So 400 there, 400 back,
mm-hmm.
and about 200 miles in is when you're ready. but it's like it was getting kind of low. Sun's getting low in the sky and everything. It's like, just got to keep going. And that's why the BMW was, after the XS11, the BMW was a bike that I thought would satisfy that long trip. And yeah, and me and my wife, we've done thousands of miles on that thing. I mean, and that's not even the best BMW to have for what I want to do,
mm-hmm.
and it's like riding a couch,
Right. But to go back to the final answer to that question really is, at that point once I figured that out, which was not even really that long ago, but the Africa Twin obviously wasn't even in production yet.
Yeah.
But I started looking at the Suzuki V-Strom DL1000.
That would be my next bike, and like I said, if it wasn't so common,
mm-hmm.
I'd own one.
Right. But again, for me, that's why that bike is so common. Yeah.
And that's nothing against it, because it's an excellent bike.
Yeah.
Because it would do everything I want it to do, like I said.
And at that time, the competitor to that was the KTM 990.
Yeah.
And you know, like, I'm not a huge KTM fan. That's probably pretty well known. But the KTM 990 was one bike that I was really, really thinking about getting and looking at hard.
Well, that would have served your purpose.
Yeah,
right. If the Apertrend never ceased to exist.
Right.
I would say that was probably... Either one of those, really, would be hard to say over Suzuki, just because it'd be cheaper.
Yeah. The problem that I had with the deal with the V-Strom was it wasn't as off-road biased as I wanted. Because I know myself, and I know that once I get out there, I'm going to end up riding something that I shouldn't ride.
Yeah.
And this will keep me from killing myself.
Well, yeah. Well, and it's probably a little more off-road adventurous than the V-Strom,
right,
as far as, and that's, yeah. And that's why actually...
21-inch front tire, you know.
Well, and that's why the 990, had this not existed, probably would be your
bike. Right, that would have been my bike.
Yeah.
You're 100% right there.
Let's see. Adam Weeks says CDS is smoking like a two-stroke. actually, it's off... Actually,
you know what? I'm not smoking cigarettes. I haven't had a cigarette
I just
since
like it. But,
December 7th
but
last
I tell
year.
You, if it doesn't smell as good as a race gas, as actually mixed C12.
he's tough to please. It's caramel and strawberry.
Okay, here's a good question here. And then, like I said, we might take a quick break, and we're going to change the camera angle so we can check out this bike that we've been talking about. But here's a good, because it kind of segues into, if you don't know what the bike looks like, you'll understand when you see it. What's the longest you travel? Or I think you mean what's the longest you've traveled? And he's asking both of us, and I assume in any one ride. So what's
okay
mileage wise?
I'll give you two answers, one for each bike.
Okay.
The furthest that I ever rode on the DRZ is 250 miles. I did a 250 mile day. And I will never, ever again do a 250-mile day on a DRZ off-road. Because when I got home, I was in so much pain.
It's
not the bike's fault. I'm out of shape.
You know, it's partly the reason why a goal of mine is to do a trip back to my old stomping grounds, which is about 350 to 400 miles away.
Mm-hmm.
But if at all possible, do not travel any paved roads.
That sounds awesome.
On my DR350, though. I've seen some guy, and it's a 5-6-year-old post now,
mm-hmm,
but over on ADV Rider, there's a guy that did it on a DR200. Mm-hmm. Like, he rode across, like, four states or something.
Cool.
I don't have any aspirations doing that, but what I want to do, but the thing is I don't know if my ass is ready for that on that.
See, that was a continuous ride, though. I've done, you know, 4-day weekends where we've done 500 or 600 miles.
Yeah, but this trip would be,
you know, 100 miles a day. You know, is fine. 100 mile day on a DRZ is perfectly fine. Those last 50 miles getting back to the garage, I was ready to get up. But the answer for the Africa Twin is the weekend that I shot the video series that's current on my channel right now, Off-Road Mission Possible, I did 400 miles. And that was probably 20% road, 80% off-road. And when I pulled back into the garage, I got off the bike and was like, all right, let's go, mow the lawn, you know, whatever else I have to do for the weekend. And the difference was just astounding.
My longest ride, I'll just say my longest ride as ever was, and you know what, I can't remember exact mileage, but it was done two up on the BMW, so maybe that's cheating. I don't know. me and Katie. We went from here, Denver, to near Sioux City, Iowa. Did it all one day, about 9.5 hours or so. And I think that's like 800-ish miles, somewhere around there.
Yeah.
You know, 700-800.
But again, I'm in the situation where I haven't had the Africa Twin long enough to do a long trip on it. You know, I want to ride it down to Utah, and I want to ride distance on it, but I just haven't had time.
Had
it long enough.
Well, you haven't had it long enough.
It's still got the new bike smell.
All right, I'll take one more question, and we're going to take a quick break and change camera angles so we can see and talk about this bike a little more. The last one, I guess, is for me. Junkman, do you ride your restored F9 350? Well, you're probably talking about the one you see back there. That's actually an F5. That's a 1970. And I've ridden it very little. I've put so much work in it, I don't want to get scratched up. And I hate to say it, it's mostly a show bike, so no, I don't really ride it that much. I do have my performance project, or the F9 project, I should say, my performance version of that bike. And I don't ride that one that much either, because it's just, it beats you up. And it's not really made for trails, it's more for vintage motocross. So I gotta haul it to a track that doesn't have too gnarly a jumps, because it wasn't built for that.
Mm-hmm.
But I can only ride it for maybe at any continuous about 15-20 minutes, and then I gotta take a break when the back is shot. I'm not as young as I used to be, and I'm not that old.
Both of us are getting there, man.
But all right, yeah, let's switch it over, and let's get to the main attraction here. So
All right.
It's gonna take maybe about a little minute intermission here, and I'll put on a little bit of music for you guys, so you can listen to that, and we'll be back in just a minute. Here it is, the main attraction here. Probably, hopefully, what you came to see in the video, rather than us two lunkheads just talking in two chairs here.
But that's what we do.
Anyway, this is brand new and one of only a few that are in the country. Is that the
a few that are in the state?
Or in the state? Okay. Yeah. Like I said, if you've watched this video, you already know most, if not all, this story. But let's kind of tell it for the people who maybe have not heard it. How you acquired it, because they weren't taking pre-orders or something for this, or
only. I'll tell the story.
Start with the beginning. Okay. I'm gonna give it off to him.
So here's what happened: was the bike was pre-ordered out the wazoo, and then what happened was there was a earthquake in Japan, which stopped manufacture of the bike. So what ended up happening was each dealership got a certain number of bikes, and then they were told, you're just going to either have to wait for subsequent shipments or until we can resume production and, you know, carry on.
Makes sense. I mean, that seems like that happened. I can remember a similar situation happened, I don't remember the year, but it happened one other time. I remember it being big news in the press. I think this might have been before internet kind of thing, or before major internet, I should say.
So what happened was I finally gave up on my V-Strom 1000 990 search when I started doing a little bit more research on a family vacation where I couldn't ride, so I actually had time to read material and watch videos and do all that stuff because we had a lot of downtime, and I absolutely fell in love with the Africa Twin. And
now what did you at first when you found out that they're kind of unlimited supply, at least right now?
What was your
thought then? Was like, geez, I gotta wait till 2017, 2018.
I didn't know at that point.
Okay.
I decided that I wanted the bike, so I went in to my shopping experience thinking,
I'm just gonna get
the bike that I want.
Okay.
I had no idea.
Oh man, like, that's gotta be a major letdown.
Yeah. No, I had no knowledge whatsoever. So I started. I went to Honda and I filled out all the paperwork and set up the bike that I wanted to have.
Okay, so like through the website.
Yeah, I mean, I was
find a dealer. And
yeah,
and
I was
okay.
expecting it was going to take a
sure.
month or two, and then I had
yeah, well, that's pretty typical.
The bike with everything that I wanted
yeah,
on
yeah.
it, perfectly the way I wanted it. And that's not what happened at all.
So what kind of message did you get when you went through all that, and all of a sudden it's like, oops, sorry? Because I think
a
Hellcat owner or wannabe Hellcat owners probably found that out, you know, with the Dodge.
I started reading some forum posts, actually, is where I found on ADV Rider.
So they didn't tell you, they just sent the email. Oh, you're one of the
users. Yeah, just said, okay, you know, your credit app's being processed.
sneaky Honda.
Yeah, we'll have a dealer contact you.
Sneaky, drum up. Do they have a deal like Nintendo with the Amiibo deal? Is that what they were trying? You know, maybe that's what they're doing with this.
Well, I think they're, you know, they're trying to fill back orders.
God, I can't believe I'm making that reference.
Yeah.
All right. Go on.
So I set the dealer that I wanted to deal with as RPM over in Lakewood, and they called me the next day, and the guy said I knew now at this point that the bikes were not available, and I was surprised to get a call. But anyway, he said, I have a bike on the floor. It doesn't have a tag on it. If you want it, your credit app's been approved. You can come and I'll put a tag on it if you tell me that you're going to take it.
So was it just that dealer wasn't doing the pre-order?
Right.
So it was first come, first serve?
Yes.
Okay,
so RPM is just, if they get a bike, they're building it,
okay.
they're putting it on the floor, okay. they're not telling anybody or anything. If you walk in and they have a bike on the floor and it doesn't
have
a tag on it.
But I wonder how they obviously put in an order, but I wonder how they were lucky enough to get one.
Well, I think they told me that they sold one previous to this one.
Okay.
So I think me and one other guy might be like the lucky people. All
right. Well,
they got one in Lakewood.
That's pretty neat.
It turned out that it turned out perfectly because the only thing that was different about this bike than what I wanted was the color. And I'm not seriously concerned about the color, so, you know, gray's fine with me.
Hides the dust.
Yeah.
Better than your black Messina.
I do like the black, red, and white. It's a little flashier, but you know,
yeah.
for a long distance bike where it's going to be, you know, more me touring, and flashy doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
No. But it was manual. It was not the DCT. And I know a lot of people are like, why did you not get the DCT version? And my answer to that question is,
why don't you tell everybody what that means for those that are not in tune to the spec? Like I said, I've read up a little bit about. I don't know a lot about it as far as the end, but I've looked up spec-wise. So, yeah, why don't we explain that?
So this bike gets sold in two variations. There's the 6-speed manual, which is your regular motorcycle with a shifter and a clutch.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the DTC, which stands for dual clutch transmission. And basically what that is it's like your everyday automatic transmission car.
Kind of. The semi-auto.
Yeah,
anyway.
Pretty much.
It's
there's no shifting.
Yeah. Well, basically, like... Yeah, I mean, Honda experimented with kind of those bikes. It didn't sell very well to me, early 80s, but the Honda-matic, as some might know. I mean, it's different than
that.
It's different than this, but similar concept. For those out there that need something to reference.
Yeah, you put the bike in drive and you drive.
Yeah.
The reason that I didn't want that is because that's what I drive to work every day. It's an automatic transmission.
Yeah.
When I want to get on my motorcycle.
Well, that's the fun of being a motorcycle. Shift your own gear.
Running through the gears is three quarters of the fun
yep.
of me. You know?
Exactly.
So that's so.
Having to pay attention and do something instead of this auto drive type of.
I rode Dr. Dual Sports, what is WR450F, which you put a recluse clutch in.
Yep.
And I still pulled the clutch. I couldn't help myself.
Yeah, although I thought hard, long and hard about those recluses for my KX250 that I've kind of converted to more of a trail racer, if you want to say, just for slow speed maneuvering. But I understand
where they have a place in the industry and why people do enjoy them, and I don't knock anybody for having them, but for me it takes away from the challenge and also the fine tuning of your riding.
Yep.
And that to me would
why I would modify to a hydraulically actuated clutch before I go to the recluse, just to get that even finer.
Yeah, it takes away from the experience in my mind. But that's my personal opinion.
Yep. No, I can understand that. That's partly the reason why I haven't spent the money on it. Because if I hated it, then
you're out a whole bunch of money.
Yeah.
But it worked out perfectly that they had a manual transmission, ABS, ready to go.
Now, is ABS standard or is it an option?
So that's a question that I have too, because they call this the standard ABS.
Because I know BMW does that. Well, maybe not with their most current bikes, but their older ones, there are eight.
I've never seen any documentation on one that doesn't have ABS. Mm-hmm. So I'm inclined to say that yes, all of them have ABS.
I would think so. Just in this day and age, why wouldn't you? I mean, I used to think it was kind of dumb to have dumb on cars, like, because I remember driving old cars where you had to have a technique to pump the brakes, but
my car doesn't have ABS.
But you know, it's like, why not? For me, it doesn't take away from the experience. So no. I don't know why they would have a non-ABS. I was a little curious because
I always thought ABS was weird on a bike. I never really understood it until I got this and started riding it around and did some emergency braking practice. And now I understand.
Yeah. I'd have it on all my bikes if it was easily adaptable.
Right, so there's nothing like putting it to practical use to understand why it exists.
Okay, so that's one of the options.
Mm-hmm.
What are some other options? I mean, you recently put on some accessories, but, this is obviously aftermarket, but is there some other, factory options that you have or don't have? Or
yeah, actually, I just picked it up before we came over here, and what I had done was I had the taller windscreen installed. With the shorter windscreen, it was getting just to the very my forehead, and it was causing a lot of buffeting on my forehead, and I was doing this while I was riding down the road, and that's just not comfortable. Now, for anybody that might pick one of these up, there is a mod that you can do, aside from buying the taller windscreen. What they do is they actually put spacers
in. I was going to say, probably there's...
They put spacers in here and here, and it pushes the screen forward a little bit.
Ah, so...
And it pushes the air up higher. And that was a suggestion that a bunch of people made to me on Ibar, one of the Facebook groups.
Actually, folks, I mean, just me looking at it, not knowing exactly, go to Ace Hardware, get some brass tubing, and just cut it with a hacksaw. There's a cheap mod for you guys.
That's exactly what they do.
Maybe put a washer on top of it or something, just to support that little hole around out there.
So that's
a good tip.
Yeah. So going back to when I had already filled out the paperwork for the bike that I didn't get.
Yep.
I had already added the taller windscreen. I had already added the 12-volt socket, which does not come stock.
I find odd for a bike marketed.
Yeah.
Or this kind of person,
that
it should just
really
come that way.
Yeah.
But
and especially the amount they wanted to charge.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure
they're $20 on Amazon.
Yeah.
Come on. And then the last thing that I had done, which was not on this bike when I bought it, was the center stand.
Yeah, and he told me that, I love bikes with center stands, but why not just come from the factory?
I don't understand it. Apparently,
I mean, it doesn't really take away from your ground clearance hardly at all, because it tucks up. It doesn't hang any lower than your suspension linkage. So I don't know why they even.
You know, this is the most I've looked at it since I got it.
But anyways, I mean, that's odd. Okay.
So those were the three sort of basic things that I ordered. I did order the Honda panniers on the website. But I had a chance to rethink that, in part because I read some reviews where they're a little flimsy and that there are better aftermarket options out there.
Yeah, I mean, I have a GV or GB or whatever box to complement my stock BMW bag, and they're great, or the one I have is great.
That's actually, I'm thinking about kitting this bike out all in GB. I'm going with GB.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm going to do
Swedish or something.
I'm going to do the Gibby.
Well, what I like is their stuff is really modular and kind of like baby car seats. Is
mm-hmm.
when you buy one mount, you can
right.
change things around. You can kind of put it anywhere, or you can, and that's a good great way to find people who are getting rid of their stuff.
Right. Yeah, that's a good idea too.
Used.
But the crash bars and the skid blade are going to be first, and then second is going to be panniers of some.
Yeah,
some
you're
going to
love. Yeah, you're going to love having.
I don't know what I'm going to get.
Well, and
I've owned this forever, and this was on the back of Xena,
yep.
and it just is perfect for me to carry a water bottle. And
well, and then getting the trunk, if you get the trunk box,
yeah.
it makes it good for a backrest for two of them.
For Miss Stacy.
Yep.
Miss
yep.
Stacy's going to sit on here.
Which actually, I'll tell you about that a little later, because that is a backrest I made. I can tell you how to make that your own yourself. Actually, or you can go to my wife's blog and see the instructions how to make it.
So yeah, it's good to have friends.
Yeah. I mean, because they sell, that's about $50 if you buy that.
Some of this stuff blows my mind.
Yeah,
expensive.
You can build that for about $10 in materials.
For a little Farkle that you get, you know, it's $150, and you're like, this thing was made for $5 or less.
Yeah.
That drives me nuts.
So, I mean, so are you all through the break-in procedure and or mileage and got the break-in oil out?
The break-in's done. Oil got changed at 600 miles.
Okay.
Had it first service. I took it in and had the first service done.
Okay. So now you're ready to flog it.
And before I took that 400-mile trip, that was all done. So that 400-mile trip was where I got it off-road for real for the first time. Oh, and the tires.
Yeah, well, and like I said, if you've seen his videos, he's talked extensively about the tires.
Yeah.
Go and check out his video about it, and then you can tell what tires he chose and why.
At that point, it was ready for me to take it off-road and get on it a little bit. So yeah, I did that, and boy, going from 460s to 1,000 is a big difference.
I'm sure. But, you're pretty well-versed on that little 400, so... It probably wasn't that big of a jump, other than somewhat muscling the weight around, probably at the slow speeds.
The weight of the bike was definitely a factor, but it was very, very manageable, and I wasn't caught off guard at any point during that ride, during that 400 miles.
That's good.
I did, what I would have done on Xena, and although I was a little more cautious than I would have been on Xena, just, diving right into it, because I'm very familiar with that bike. This bike handled all of that extremely well, and I never was scared or anything like that.
Okay. So and I know there's one hot button subject, but I'll bring it up. What is the one thing you don't like on this bike?
Right, I've also made a bit of a statement about that as well. And I found out that this is actually an industry standard across all motorcycles. KTM, BMW, Tiger, what are the Tigers?
The Triumph Tigers is, I think it's got 900 or something.
Yeah.
900, 950.
But all of the adventure touring bikes, the ADV bikes that have ABS and or traction control, the standard stock setting, as soon as you put the key in and turn the bike on, is that traction control is going to be at the maximum and the ABS is going to be on. And on all of those bikes, there's no way to, when you take the key out, put the key back in, turn the bike on, to have it set to off, both of those to off. I think it's got to be some type of safety standard for the industry.
Or for importation. National Safety Transportation Administration.
But I keep getting caught not thinking about it, because I just jump on, I stop on the side of the trail, take a drink of water, have a smoke, whatever, get back on Xena, and take off down the trail, and I'm good to go.
Yeah.
Every time I stopped on this bike, I would start driving down the trail, and all of a sudden the traction control would be kicking in, and I'd be like, what the? Oh, man.
So no power sliding until you realize, oh, yeah.
Right. Well, I mean, who doesn't like power sliding?
Yeah. Well, that's what I mean, that's common plain in cars these days. You can't have any fun with them unless you turn all that stuff on.
that's what they made fire roads for, right?
Exactly.
It's not fire, it's driving dirt bikes.
Exactly. Exactly.
But yeah, so that's my hot button complaint with this bike, and to put that in perspective, if that's my biggest complaint, this bike is amazing.
Yeah, well, like I said, I would find it just be a minor inconvenience. I mean,
that's what it is.
I mean, no bike's gonna be perfect or anything.
And I still think that that Herman and I need to get together and design something that's going to fix that for all these
people. Well, if you don't do it, somebody will.
I want to be a millionaire, so I'd like to do it first.
Yeah. Well, if you can make it so it's universal across the industry,
that's the point.
But I'm afraid probably certain languages might be a little bit different across different ECMs, but I don't know.
You don't know our Funyun eater, though. Our Funyun eater knows his stuff.
The other thing I was going to ask you is maybe, maybe they don't even make them yet aftermarket, is some sort of crash bar or anything.
Yeah, that's what I was
going to say. Because it's only a problem if you happen to fall down just right.
Yeah. But,
and this is a problem with most water-cooled four-stroke bikes, is, your water pump and water pump housing here, which is part of your clutch cover, rock right there, all the water's going out.
Done. Right. The reason I was asking about your Givi stuff is because Givi makes a two-part crash bar.
They make
lower bars, and then they make a bar that's going to come up and protect the fairing as well, that goes all the way
around. Yeah, because I'll tell you, sport bike guys know this, this is the most expensive part of the bike right here,
uh-huh.
Or part of the most expensive part of the bike.
But it's also the easiest part to break.
Exactly. Yep. Yep.
Yeah. And I know, some love scratches are nice, but I'd like to not.
Yeah. No. I'm
not
gonna
do that on this one. She's already got a few.
That's like all my Kickstart bikes, is they have black marks on the. On the number plates right here, because
right.
Of the boot.
Right.
That's just par for the course.
She's
here.
An off-road bike. All I can do is try and keep her as nice as I can for as long as I can, and that's an acceptable goal to me.
Yeah. All right. You know what? I'm going to go take a few questions, but I got to hop over out of frame and see what you're chatting about, because we want to answer some questions about this bike.
I'll dance with you.
Oh, let's see here.
Me and Tyler to be in a robe right now.
Okay, well, Adam Week says center stand is handy for side off for a trail flat. Yes, I would agree with that.
Center stand is going to come in handy cleaning the chain on this bike, because without it, I'd have to have Miss Stacy roll it while I clean the chain.
Okay, well, we're getting a question about the tires,
okay.
Which from the FLB Club.
Ah.
Yeah, we know who you are.
What's up, FLB?
Are those the stock tires, and when do you think you'll change them to? I know how much you love the D606.
Mm.
I'd pay to see that. Well, I know the answer, but I'll let you answer that.
All right, FLB, I can tell that you haven't watched my last two videos, but no, these are not the stock tires. These are the Midas EO7s, and they are a 50-50 tire. The reason that I picked them specifically over the Ken Heidenau K60 Scout, which was the other top leader, is because on the rear tire, the K60 Scout in this size has a continuous center lug that goes all the way around, and it has separate lugs on the side. And the Midas EO7 does not have that center lug. There's a break in between, which will be optimal for our P-Gravel Rampart Range kind of stuff. You know what I'm talking about. And that's why I picked these tires.
Okay, yeah, and let's see, we have...
If you want a comparison while he's looking up another question, go to the Facebook page. There's a picture of the stock tire next to the new tire on the bike. If you scroll down a little bit on Colorado Dual Sport Facebook.
Yeah, let's see here.
It comes with street tires.
Ugh. Let's see here. Oh, well, Adam Weeks says, how hard is it to toggle through the settings? And I'm guessing he's talking about the ABS and the more the traction control, I guess. Because mm-hmm. What did you say? There's three settings?
There's three settings for the traction control, and then there's ABS off for the rear tire only. Those are the four settings that you have to go through on this bike. Aside from your standard, other stuff.
I'll do a little bit of follow-up. Have you used any other setting other than off?
Okay.
And if so, do you notice a jump from, you know, like the lots of traction control or backing the throttle off to the moderate to the very little to then off? I assume that's how it's kind of set up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So this will be a good one for a bunch of you guys that are current on my videos, because you haven't seen the end of this series yet, where I kind of get down to brass tacks with it. Using traction control mode number 3 in the dirt is a recipe for disaster. It almost sent me over the handlebars.
Now, traction control 3, what is that one?
That is the most traction control.
Okay, the most
number
aggressive.
3 is the highest.
Okay, so you whack whack that throttle open, it cuts the fuel or the ignition, however it does it, and you have nothing.
And you have no power.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. Almost sent me over the handlebars a couple of times going up some bumpy hill climbs. Is a recipe for disaster. For the most of that trip, I've used traction control mode number 2, which was a lot better. It still cut power sometimes when I really wished it didn't, but I didn't feel like it was nearly as unsafe as traction control mode number 3. What I ended up using towards the end of the trip was traction control mode number 1, which is not the least. You can actually turn it off, but traction control mode number 1 seemed to be absolutely perfect. And the great thing about this bike, I don't know about the others, the other manufacturers, is on the fly, there's a little trigger underneath the clutch that you can hit on the fly and change the traction control mode. So
nice. So it's okay. That would have been, I mean, nobody's saying that, but that would have been my follow-up question.
Mm-hmm.
Would have been, yeah, is it easy to change on the fly?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's good.
So when I would start riding and I would notice that it was in number 3 because it cut the power when I first started out in first gear, I would just reach down here and go click, click, and I'm in number 1 and I can proceed to ride.
Nice.
The issue that I have with the ABS and turning it off is that you cannot change that on the fly. The bike has to be standing still. It doesn't necessarily have to be in neutral, but
now,
it has to be stopped.
Now, other than a brake slide, why would you want to turn the ABS off?
Because if you're a fan of my channel, you know that I don't like engine braking down steep hills. I like using front and rear brake independently. For me, having something manipulating what I'm trying to do with the brake is counterproductive. So that's my personal reason.
Yeah, okay, I can see that, because it'd be hard to go back and forth. I guess it's kind of like people know me as it's a little hard for me to go back and forth from my BMW with a totally dry automotive style clutch versus a wet style like in almost any other motorcycle because of the way it just grabs. And it's probably similar. Okay, that makes sense. I guess I never really thought of it that way.
It's a mental thing.
Yeah, I guess.
Because I know if it's starting to hang and the rear wheel is starting to slide, I can lessen up on the rear brake, get a little harder on the front, and still maintain the amount of deceleration or the amount the bike is holding me back as I had. So for me, that's something that I got growing up riding BMX and mountain bikes and stuff, and that's just something that a skill that transferred over for me to motorcycles. Whereas engine braking didn't exist in those scenarios.
Yeah, and I use a combination of them all. I mean, I like engine braking.
I do as well.
But
it depends on.
But I modulate it with the clutch, so I mean, I guess it's kind of the same deal. I could see how that could be disconcerting when you're grabbing that front brake lever with, say, a one finger deal, because you don't want to be nailing it, and then all of a sudden you get the pulse from the ABS kicking in, and
it'll freak you out quick.
Yeah, I guess it's like the first time I drove a car with ABS and. You know, hit a slick spot, and I was ready to start just pumping my foot, and then it, you know.
Feeling that out of your brake pedal on you're like,
okay, yeah.
And I mean, in the dirt, it's constantly activated.
Of course.
Because there's no
traction. Of course it is.
So even just slowing down, you're going to have the ABS kick in.
We have Life with Lurch.
What's up, Lurch?
Have you named her yet? Or is it a her? I mean,
it is definitely a her, and I do have a name, but I'm not going to give it away here. Sorry, Jumpman.
Hey, I didn't ask. I knew we weren't going to.
Yes, I do have a name. I have picked one, Lurch, but it'll be revealed soonish.
Don't worry, it's coming. All right, Adam Weeks asks another question. Have you bought on the suspension yet? I'm guessing probably no, but...
I think I did. So it wasn't a seriously, like, it wasn't a crunch, but I think I got to the bottom of it on those trails over in Jefferson. I took a, I don't know, it's not even a whoop, but what do you call those things that they do for drainage where the road just humps?
Oh, yeah.
One of those.
Well, I would call it a whoop.
Yeah.
A whoop-de-doo is multiple ones in succession, I guess, technically.
So one of those intentional trail drains where the trail goes like that, I hit one of those a little fast, and instead of letting the bike suspension handle it with me staying rigid, I rose up and therefore let the suspension expand all the way out. And then when I came back down, it felt like I found the bottom, but I, like I said, it wasn't a terrible crash.
You didn't hear a kerbang, that bike right there. Yeah.
It felt like I found a solid bottom, but I don't know 100% sure. But I rode the hell out of it that weekend, and the suspension handled flawlessly with my big butt.
Well, it's got some healthy forks up there. I'm liking that they put some heavier duty type forks, because sometimes on these adventure bikes, those little forks seem kind of spindly in my opinion. But it looks like Honda did their homework on that kind of thing.
The only thing they skimped on is the foot pegs.
Yeah, but even motocross bikes that are supposed to be race ready out of the box have the suckiest foot pegs. So
those foot pegs are off of a Honda 50.
Of course, of course.
They're garbage.
Yeah. Well, I could have showed you the stalkers that were on my KX.
I did just see a video from a company called Black Dog Racing that said that they're having foot pegs on final production next week. So I don't know anything about them. We're not associated at all. But apparently they're going to be coming out with different manufacturers here shortly, because there is no aftermarket pegs that don't need modification on the market right now.
That's odd.
XR 650, XR 650R pegs if you sand them down a little
bit.
They have to be drilled out.
And I see the angle that they put, the way they have. I do like this beefy mount they put, but yeah, I guess you're right, because the angle wouldn't be the right. I was thinking, what's like my, they're aftermarket.
There's actually a thing going on right now, so I'm gonna coin it peg gate with the Honda Africa Twin, because apparently one that I know of, and possibly one other, have had the foot peg mount snap off.
This just came in, and I forgot about this, but 10 Cup Pass Racing says, put a zip tie around the fork, and then you can tell how far your forks are. That's a very good tip. I didn't think of that right off. That comes back from my motocrossing days. Sometimes you do that to kind of figure out, if you got, after you've set up your sag, you'd figure out, after riding and doing a big G out, you'd figure out, that would be kind of how you figured out if you had the right spring rate in the front.
Right.
Front fork. So, yeah, that's a good tip there.
And I want you guys to know that I haven't done anything to the suspension. I haven't changed either of the clickers. I haven't done anything. This is all out of the box.
Yeah, well,
so for a big guy, I think it's
the suspension takes a while to get itself broke in, because it doesn't wear as much as the engine. But I'd dig the manual and figure out which clicker does what.
Yeah.
And I play around with them, because you can get a lot of performance out of what the factory gives you before you think you really need to go to aftermarket. I think on that bike you don't have to. Xena, I'd say differently, but
yeah, Xena.
But especially because of your weight, you know.
Yeah.
But
I'm a big guy.
You know, differently.
I'm not afraid of it, but yeah, I mean, this bike handles me and my size very well. The next thing that I'm gonna do to it, and I'm actually kind of disappointed in myself that I haven't ordered them already, is bar risers.
So you think the handlebars still need a little more height for you?
They're
too
low for me when I stand up.
Are they rubber mounted? Oh yes, they are. Good.
Yeah. So that's good. So I should just be able to throw your standard 30 millimeter riser in there.
Yeah, actually, because that's just an infinite bar in under it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Let's see, and you should have plenty of. I don't know. Let's see.
They might be zipped. Oh no, they're in this cradle.
Well, what I was saying is you got to have enough brake line.
To pull it up.
To pull it up, but you know what? I think Actually, I think you do.
Lots of people have done it.
Yeah, so I was going to say, because usually that's your limiting factor, but actually, no, it looks like they put enough in there for it.
Yeah.
I know a lot of people have put them on there before they've even ridden it off of the shower floor.
Yeah, well,
they're just a little too low.
Well, that's the thing is half the battle is getting the bike set up. A lot of people don't even do that. So the people that are doing that, good for them, because a lot of people think, oh, I'm going to spend all this money on suspension or they want to put pipes and more power. It's like, you know what? You want to go faster? Make the bike fit you, mm-hmm. and you'll go faster.
That is.
I mean, practice and riding technique has a lot to do with that. But
yeah.
but that's, you got the bike set up for your weight, your height, mm-hmm. where these three points line up with your body type. I mean,
mm-hmm.
this is going to be totally whacked for me. I probably have to roll them in a little bit or something, or maybe even mm-hmm. wide or narrow. I like wide bars. I like a lot of leverage. But
I end up doing the same thing. Even with Xena, she does have 30-millimeter risers, and I still ogre down like this. And it gets hard on my upper back because I'm down and pulling up, you know, trying to wheelie off of potholes and
exactly.
stuff like that. And it's unnecessary wear because I'm forced to be in the wrong position due to my height. So, whereas, John or Stacy might have an issue because they're shorter, us tall people also have the same problem because we're tall.
Yeah.
So, there's no, you know, you got to customize the bike to you to make it comfortable for you to ride.
And at this
and
point,
safe too.
Adam Week says, before you mess too much with the clickers, take note of the stock position, which that stands to reason.
Yeah.
But,
I did know that.
But, yeah. And actually, if it does have a section about that in the even the owner's manual, I know it's in the service manual, but it should even tell you where they're set from the factory. Not always, but they sometimes do.
If anybody's watching that has a link to a downloadable service manual, I'd appreciate that. If you need a downloadable owner's manual, I do have a copy of that, so hit me up. Would love to trade with somebody.
This is kind of a comment to me. You're definitely smarter than you look, Chunk Man. Well, that's my MO. I don't like to look like I know like too much, because then I'll get asked to do too much. We had a discussion about our outside of YouTube work, and I have a bad habit of saying, oh, I can figure that out.
Yeah. Yeah. You're the IT guy that learns under fire.
Yeah. Well, we've been going here for about an hour and 15 minutes or so. If I'm thinking about wrapping this up, so if anybody has any last-minute questions, I mean, we'll take them right now. Otherwise, I hope you enjoyed this stream, and I thank you for watching. Looks like we had a lot of comments in the chat and a lot of viewers in and out throughout the stream, and I hope to do this again with CDS here again, or with some other people I have in mind that may want to come down to the garage with their bike and maybe talk about them. If you really like this video, you know, leave a like, leave a comment in the comment section. Check out his Facebook page if you're not already liked to it, which a lot of you are probably. Check it out. Actually, go to his YouTube channel, subscribe to him, and you want to know more about this bike. His most recent videos from the time that this was made have a lot more information. You can see it up close. He's got some really good videos about it. So if you're on the edge about this versus the KTM or the other bikes we kind of talked about and why he chose this, you can get a little more in-depth information here. And he's always available to answer comments in it on his YouTube channel and his Facebook page.
Oh yeah.
So
it's a labor of love.
Yep. So I'm going to just check the chat real quick, and then if there's no other questions, I'm going to shut the stream down, and thanks for watching, guys.
I don't know if Noel is watching. Hi, Noel. He's up in Canada and is possibly running a combine right now. He said he wasn't sure if he was going to be able to watch or not, but I hope he did, and hope you're having a good time, Noel.
All right, thanks for watching, guys.
We'll catch you later.